two-dimensional vectors, level 2. Alright, now that we have a better understanding of what vectors are, let's go ahead and start describing vectors more precisely with coordinate points. Recall that vectors have an initial point and a terminal point. Because vectors can be described using these two points, we can describe these points by using ordered pairs in a rectangular coordinate system. For example, vector v can be represented by a directed line segment that starts at the origin, 0, 0, and ends at point 3, 2. Let's denote these points as p and q, respectively. In the same manner, we can represent vector u by a directed line segment that starts at point 1, 3, and ends at point 4, 5. Let's denote these points as point r and s, respectively. Notice that we can now describe the initial and terminal point of a vector by making use of ordered pairs in a two-dimensional coordinate system. Representing vectors in this fashion allows us to use a two-dimensional coordinate system to precisely carry out various measurements. As an example, say that we are asked to show that vector v and vector u are equivalent. How can we use the directed line segment representation of vectors to determine if they are equivalent? Let's start with the definition of equivalent vectors. In order for two vectors to be equivalent, both their magnitude and direction have to be the same. Let's first check and see if the magnitude of vector v and vector u are the same. We can find the length of each vector by making use of the distance formula learned from previous math classes. Notice that vector v is formed by point p and q. To find the magnitude of vector v, we simply take the difference of the point's x-coordinates, square the result, and add it to the difference of the y-coordinates squared. And then we take the square root of this sum. Recall that this is nothing more than an application of the Pythagorean theorem. Simplifying the expression, we obtain the square root of 13 as the magnitude of vector v. In the same manner, let's calculate the length of vector u. Similar to vector v, we find the difference of the point's x-coordinates, square them, and add it to the difference of the point's y-coordinates squared. And then we take the square root of the sum. Simplifying the expression, we obtain the square root of 13 as the magnitude of vector u. So, our first condition for vector equivalency is satisfied. Both vectors have the same magnitude. Now we need to make sure that both vectors have the same direction. Taking a look at the vectors, we see that they both have a positive slope. They seem to be pointing in the same direction. Just to make sure that this is the case, we should calculate the slope of each vector and confirm that they have the same slope. In other words, we need to check that the vectors are parallel to one another. We can determine this by calculating the rise over the run for each vector. Vector v has a rise of 2 and a run of 3. Likewise, vector u has a rise of 2 and a run of 3. Both vectors have the same slope, and both vectors are pointing in the same direction. All conditions for vector equivalency have been satisfied. So we can conclude that these two vectors are equivalent. The next concept associated with vectors that we need to understand is that a vector represents a set of directed line segments, each having the same length and direction. For example, vector v was equivalent to vector u, even though their initial and terminal points had distinct coordinate points. In the same manner, we can represent additional vectors that are equivalent to vector v. All of these vectors have the same direction and magnitude as vector v. For computational purposes, it is very convenient to work with a vector whose initial point is located at the origin. This way, the initial point is represented by the coordinate 0, 0. This representation of vector v is said to be in standard position. It is also referred to as the position vector. Notice that the standard position of a vector is essentially a directed line segment that starts at the origin and ends at a specific coordinate point of the Cartesian coordinate system. With this alternative way of representing a vector in a coordinate system, we can now describe any vector that is in standard position by simply using the coordinates of the vector's terminal point. As a final note, zero vectors in standard position will be represented by a point located at the origin, as follows. Since both its initial and terminal points lie in the same location, in this case, both points would lie at the origin. Alright, we have seen how describing vectors by using points is pretty convenient, especially if the initial point of the vector is located at the origin. An even better way of describing a vector is by using the coordinates of its terminal point. This particular way of describing a vector is referred to as the component form of the vector. And we denote it by using angle brackets as follows. The numbers v sub 1 and v sub 2 are called the components of the vector. Notice the similarities between the way you denote a point and the way you denote the component form of a vector in a Cartesian coordinate system. Because of this similarity, it is important to use parentheses when we are denoting points and use angle brackets when we are denoting vectors in component form. For example, vector v can be denoted as 2, 3. Here, the x component of vector v is 2, and the y component is 3. Note that the components of a vector essentially describe how much the vector leans in the direction of the x-axis, and how much the vector leans in the direction of the y-axis. In the same manner, the following vectors can be denoted in component form as follows. Vector A can be written as negative 1, 2. Vector B can be written as negative 2, negative 4. And vector C can be written as 3, negative 3. Keep in mind that vectors can also have a component that is equal to 0. For example, the following vectors each have a component that is equal to 0. Vector Y can be written as 0, 2. Vector W can be written as negative 2, 0. Vector X can be written as 0, negative 1. And vector U can be written as 3, 0. Also note that if both the initial point and the terminal point lie in the origin, then the vector is referred to as the zero vector, and is denoted by the following expression, 0, 0. We now have a more precise way of describing vectors, specifically by using the components of the vector. As a result, we can easily determine if two vectors are equivalent simply by making sure that their respective components are equivalent. In other words, the component form definition of a vector implies that two vectors such as v with components v sub 1 and v sub 2 and vector u with components u sub 1 and u sub 2 are equal if and only if the x components, in this case v sub 1 and u sub 1, and the y components, in this case v sub 2 and u sub 2, are equal. If we look back at the previous example, notice that both vector v and vector u had the same components. Both vectors had the same x component, in this case 3, and the same y component, in this case 2. Hence, both vectors are equivalent. The component form of a vector can also be obtained for vectors that are not in standard position. For example, vector u has an initial point given by the coordinates 1, 3, and a terminal point given by the coordinates 4, 5. We can easily find the x component of the vector by taking the x coordinate of the terminal point and subtract the x coordinate of the initial point. In this case, it will be equal to 3. In the same manner, we can take the y coordinate of the terminal point and subtract the y coordinate of the initial point. In this case, it will be equal to 2. Hence, the component form of vector u is 3, 2. In general, any directed line segment with initial points x sub 1, y sub 1, and terminal points x sub 2, y sub 2, can be represented in component form by simply finding the difference of the y-coordinates for the y-components and the difference of the x-coordinates for the x-component. Because vectors are direction-sensitive, we need to make sure we subtract the coordinates of the initial points with that of the terminal point when finding the component form of the vector. Alright, in our next video, we will practice applying these new concepts and go over a couple of examples.